unless the methodology of music analysis combined to homogenization, I think many of you well known the Gerson criterion and Gerson structure. This will be what I will record in order to show you what is the classical methodology and to put in light the difficulty that we have to face when you are dealing with a not known artist. These 2 points will be the main parts of my talk. So, in ductal fracture material, there was the ductal fracture for porous material, we have 2-3 steps. The first step is void germination or nucleation. You see that you have some particulates in the material and you generate or nucleate some biomass. The pass between the matrix and the interfaces. And the second step is void growth. During mechanical loading, when you load the material, you have some void growth for the process. And this will determine the mass of particles. And in the final part of the process, you have void fluorescence. This means that it is possible to describe the transition from continuous to failure by only use constitutive modules. This is what is classically called the local approach, in contrast to the global approach, which is based on fracture mechanics. So, my point of view.
Excuse me, the black spot there means what?
What? This spot is a particulate, and I nucleate some white.
This the relative motion of this particle with respect to the surrounding matrix causes the void.
Yes. Yes. So, this step is, I think, is difficult to model from macromechanical point of view. Many works are devoted to void growth, and lastly, we work also with Jean-Baptiste Leblanc on coalescence model. Okay. I will concentrate myself on the void growth using mechanical logic. If we are interested by geomaterials, we have to fight two things. The first one is generally you have the porosity, but also you have the fact that the solid matrix is plastically compressive. As you know, this can be modeled by Drucker-Fager model or Moore-Coulomb model. And we have in this, the particular case of this material, this is arginite used in a French project. In this case, you have to play also with nanoporosity. I will not address this problem of nanoporosity, what is the effect of nano void. This will be the purpose of the talk of Stella Dwight just after my talk. So let's come now to the context of macroporosity. The main tool is the limit analysis approach. In fact, you have 2 approaches, kinematical one and statical one. We have also recently worked on static approach, but I will not present that. I will focus on the kinematical approach. What you have is a unit cell. You have to choose a unit cell for the porous material. This is made of the holosphere, classically as the Gerson model. You have a solid matrix and you have the void. What is done for metallic material is generally you take a von Mises matrix. This is a classically incompressive matrix and the void. And what you know is the local criterion of the solid matrix, and you want to determine what is the effect of the porosity when you have an incompressive classical matrix. It has been shown several years ago. This is one of the work of Professor Jean Samson, that you can alternatively represent the yield criterion by what is called a support function. In fact, it's maximum local dissipation, plastic dissipation, which is defined like that as a sub of sigma, which is the Cauchy stress tensor. I'm sorry, Francesco. And D is the strain rate tensor. So, for von Mises matrix, for instance, it's sigma 0, D equivalent. So, to have the Sapat function
the criteria is mathematically exactly the same thing.
So what you want to do, this is what you know for the local metrics. What you have to complete now,
this is also a theorem coming from PSUP, Papier de Bien and others.
You have to construct the macroscopic dissipation of the materials,
and this macroscopic dissipation will give you what is the macroscopic yield function or yield criterion.
So the main difficulty of the approach is to determine this quantity, which is the macroscopic quantity depending on the macroscopic scale rate tensor, and this is obtained by making the average on the local plastic dissipation, but you have to choose the kinematical adhesive prior velocity field. So you have to do two things. First, to choose a kinematical prior velocity field, and second, to success to compute this quantity. When you have P of D, so you can have, this is a support function of the macroscopic behavior, you can determine the macroscopic yield function as the derivative of P of with respect to D. Okay? So, it's exactly what Wilson has done 30 years ago. In the simple case of Mises criterion, this is the von Mises criterion. And in the case of von Mises criterion, you have just to choose an incompressive velocity field. This means that a velocity field with divergence equal to zero. And this is what Wilson has chosen. It's a very simple velocity field. This part is the solution, the exact solution of the holosphere under hydrostatic logic. And this is a homogenized deviatory scale rate tensor. So this is very, very simple, but it's work. And with some success to obtain a macroscopic yield criterion, you have a compressive plastic solid matrix. But now, what you obtain is a criterion depending on the equivalent stress and also on the hydrostatic part. And this is particularly the contribution of the porosity. This means that you have plastic solid, incompressive solid matrix, but at the macroscopic level, you have now pressure-sensitive materials. Okay? If we examine in detail, the work of Wilson, it can be proved. This was some papers that we recently published, or Kazaku also. You can show that, in fact, due to some approximation, Wilson lost the effect of load angle. In fact, if you make the computation without some approximation, what we will obtain is a criterion which depends on all the free stress environments. Okay? An interesting result due to Professor Tim Rice is that when you finish to build the macroscopic criterion, it has been shown independently of this work that the normality rule that you assume at the local level, this is the assumption of limit analysis. This normality rule transposed at the macroscopic level. This means that the determination of the criterion allowed to build the macroscopic constitutive law. It's for that reason that I will focus on the yield criterion, but you have to have in mind that if I have the macroscopic criterion, I have all the constitutive law. In fact, there is some point that I have to point out also is that I have the normality rule on this. On the, this is D, in fact, on the strain rate tensor. But we have to compute also the porosity evolution law. This makes some coupling, damage-like coupling between plasticity and the plasticity and damage. In fact, if you examine my this, an interesting question is, if I put this law, which comes from the mass conservation balance, is all the macroscopic model still the standard generalized materials? And this is a big question. I'm preparing a paper now on this point. In fact, from the thermodynamic point of view, the porosity is not a state variable. Okay, I will not say more on this point because it's what I'm writing now. Olivier Coussy has made some thermodynamic approach for poroplastic saturated material. In fact, you have to move to the approach of
Olivier, aussi to understand what you have you see. And here is the fact that you have four pressure equal to zero, and you can show that this is not the thermodynamic value.
What is that?
This is the M is the hydrostatic part of the strain rate tension.
And the dot
is it here and put H and here and I'm sorry. Okay. The dot is the evolution.
And on the right hand side.
Ah, it's not there is no dot. Okay?
The dot is strain rate tension.
I'm sorry.
If this is not a state variable, it means that it depends on the loading paths.
Yes. Yes.
That's true.
Yes, and in fact, the state value is this one, okay, from the thermodynamic point of view. I hope that you see enough in the paper of the review. But this is a very important question because people work on poroplasticity with crystal material and they do not address this question. And it seems for me that it's a very important question to know if the model is standard generalized. From this one, it's standard generalized one. But you put this equation which comes from the mass balance equation, which is not obtained from homogenization. It's for that reason that the question is important. Okay, now let's come to the main part of my work is that I would like to make the same thing as Gibson, but by considering now more Coulomb matrices. What I have in fact in mind is geomaterials. This is very difficult problem due to several things. The first one I will show you that the Mach-Coulomb matrix depends on all the stress invariant in contrast to Gibson, which depends only on equivalent stress. The plastic admissibility compressivity condition is very complicated in the case of Gibson incompressibility. Here I have something which will be complicated. So we obtain that the problem is very different from the Gibson one. We have not just to compute the pion of D, but we are now faced in a problem of minimization, and we have to solve this minimization problem. It's quite, I will try to show right now. So, people working on porous matrix with Coulomb matrix, but it's just they make some correction, they add some heuristic or ad hoc correction of the Gibson model. And this is not good to do that. Because the compressibility of the matrix, specificity of the material, and you cannot, from purely macroscopic point of view, correct the Gibson model to obtain that. And it's for that reason that, so that you can make some study, make some papers in good journal, but you can follow the bad way. And you have to come back and to analyze the problem. It's very important to do that. Now, let's come. This is a paper that I am criticizing now, but it's not so important. Now, the open question is, can we obtain the macroscopic criteria when I have a compressive matrix and depending on the load angle, which is the case of Mach-Coulomb. The Mach-Coulomb criterion can be written with stress invariant. This is the second invariant, the equivalent stress. This is the first invariant, hydrostatic part. And this is the load angle. As you know, the load angle, the definition is like that, is defined with G3, which is the first stress invariant, and on C, equivalent stress. So, let's see on this figure what is the situation when you are dealing with a prepared packet matrix is something like that, sigma equivalent plus alpha, sigma m, minus sigma 0, alpha 0. This is the prepared packet one. It depends on two invariants, sigma equivalent and the hydrostatic part. But if you are looking on the p plane, which is the plane with sigma m constant, what you obtain for the Drucker packet is something like that, the same of this one. The Drucker packet material do not depend on the field environment. This is not the case for the Coulomb, but you have to describe. There are several regimes, and this regime are noted here, this regime and the others. And it's something very, very complicated that we will see on the computation. So, the classical presentation of the Mach-Coulomb matrix is something with stress invariant, but it's exactly equivalent to what I have shown before. Professor Samson has computed several years ago the support function of this criterion. This is something like that, the support function is H is the resistance, the strength to hydrostatic, it's exactly what is on the criterion of that. Multiplied by phase of D, this is Dm, but the classic compressibility condition is very complicated, it's something phase of D greater or equal to this one. This one is the principal value of the state of the tensor, and this is the symmetry of the friction angle. If I have to deal with Drucker area, it's something, it's exactly the same expression, but I have something which is written like that. It's difficult also, but it's less complicated by from this, from comparatively more volumetric due to the presence of this absolute value of the strain rate tensor. Okay? So we have two difficulties. The first one is choose to obtain a clear density field, but we have to play with this plastic compressibility equation. So the first one, I follow just what Guisson has done, but for the particular case of the first one is to choose the velocity field. I was very surprised that the problem of holosphere under hydrostatic loading with Coulomb metric has not been solved before. I was surprised. I looked for that. That this doesn't. So we have solved this problem. This was the very short paper that we proposed with Pascal Théoré and Tau in contre-rendu mécanique when we designed the exact solution to the hydrostatic. This is the solution that we obtained. Better depend on the friction angle and the traction or compression loading, which is determined by epsilon. So we have a velocity field. This one is like the Guisson has done, is a homogeneous part of the velocity field, but now it's compressible, but it's not as compressive as in the Guisson model. And that the difference of the Guisson approach, we have one, two, and three parameters which enters in this velocity field. Unfortunately, all these parameters cannot be determined exactly by boundary condition as in the case of Guisson. So, we have A1 and A2 as function of A0, which is a parameter we have to minimize the result with respect to this parameter. This was the first difficulty. And this means that, in contrast to Guisson, I have just to compute P on of T, here I have to minimize the result with respect to this parameter. I move now to optimization problem. The second difficulty that I tell you is the plastic compressibility. This means that with this velocity, we have to calculate at the local step, we have to compute the principal value of the strain rate tensor, but we have to discuss about the sign of this principal strain rate tensor value. This is difficult because it's something which depends on the position on the whole sphere, and we have to examine this. I can tell you that we have spent about 6 months on this particular point. First, the results are not so exact, and we have to correct this one. Okay, so this is something that we have solved, but it's not just only 1 week that we obtained this, and I will put this, the plastic compressibility, as something which in this form. In fact, what you have here is a local condition, and we have to move after that to an average condition because it's difficult to verify this at each point of the holosphere. So the minimization problem that we have to solve is this one. We have still to compute the macroscopic plastic dissipation, but subjected to the condition that A0 must be is obtained as a parameter that we have to minimize. And this is the plastic compressibility. The difficulty is to verify this plastic compressibility. You remove to simplify the minimization problem, which consists to verify the plastic admissibility in an average sense. Okay, this is just to put, to point out part of the difficulty that we have. So I have to solve this minimization problem, and the idea that we have is not me, my postdoc student, is to use the classical Lagrangian method. So you introduce a Lagrangian function, which is the minimization of that, the function that we have to minimize. Okay, 5 minutes. I did 20 minutes, but in 5 minutes, I tried. So you have to solve this problem of Lagrangian by using Carouche-Coulomb-Tupper condition. And this is exactly what we've done now. It's the minimization with respect to A0, to the with respect to D, and with respect to the condition which give the classic admissibility condition coming from there. Okay? So we success after this minimization procedure to obtain a macroscopic figure, not in the form of a Gaussian one, but it's exactly from mathematical point of view, the same thing. It's a parametric form of the criterion. This is completely analytic. We don't, you don't need to follow all the steps of our work to use this. This is a plastic criterion which can be put in the computer code and used for consecutive knots. So this is a parametric equation, and this quantity depends on the feather, the sign of the feather value, because our computation is just for accessibility loading now. But this is something which is completely analytic, and you can see that I think the paper that will be published, I think, in a few months in GMPS for the analytical part, and the second part of the GMPS for numerical part. In this, at this stage, I have to say hallelujah and sing like Professor Francesco Delisola singing. But I have just something with beats, and I think that this
very ridiculous to put the Beatles at this stage. Okay, but it's a very important result that we obtain. It's the first time that some result with matrix depend on all stress and variant, and the Tresca matrix obviously appear as a particular part of this result, because you know that Tresca can be obtained from Coulomb by putting the friction angle equal to zero. An interesting result that we obtain also is the void growth result. At the difference of the Gaussian model, you have a part which comes from the hydrostatic part of the strain rate tensor, but you have something which comes from the equivalent part also and the fed stress invariant. Interestingly, this form of the void growth equation has been proposed recently by Professor Atkinson from a purely heuristical point of view. This is the correction that I'm talking to you about of the Gaussian model. They have put some correction. Unfortunately, they put also the deviatoric stress, which has nothing to do in this equation, because it's a static quantity, and in this you see also that only that you have a kinematic condition. Okay, let's move quickly in 3 minutes about the result that we obtain. This is the effect of the porosity. Remember that at the initial stage you have just a Coulomb matrix. This means that you have some cone of Coulomb cone, and now with porosity, what you have is porosity of 5%, 10%. The effect of porosity is very important. In particular, you know that for Coulomb material, the strength to the hydrostatic compression ratio is infinity. Here you have some finite value of the strength of the hydrostatic loading, compressive loading. This has been observed, for instance, for material like chalk. Jean Fouchao has made some experiments in Lille on chalk, and you can see that you have plasticity under hydrostatic compression. This is due to the collapse of the void. Interestingly, this is the effect of the fed invariant, it's asymmetric loading. It's this curve that we put now here. You see that there is some asymmetry between this part and this one. The last thing that we have to do is to assess carefully this criterion, because during the process we have made some approximation. If not, we don't succeed to obtain analytical results. So it is important to validate this approach by performing numerical results. Fortunately, we have some collaboration with Professor Joseph Pasteur. We get a very nice tool. This tool is a numerical limit analysis approach, which allows to compute upper and the lower bound of the exact solution. This means that if you don't know the exact solution, don't mind. You want to have an upper and lower bound of this. And if these bounds are very close, you success to obtain quite the exact result. This is an example of this in the case of Coulomb material, lower and the upper bound. It's quite exact. Now we have to put this with our criteria. We are very surprising that the result that we obtain approximately with the analytic one, this is the case for 1%, 10%, and 5% for friction angle of 5 degrees. This is a very low friction angle. Our result, analytical result, are quite similar to the numerical bond. For me, this was a surprise because before doing this, I think that our result will be something there, which will be a very good result. But our approximations are not so crude as we think in the first stage of our work, and it seems that the results are quite good. This is another case. Now the porosity is fixed, and we vary the friction angle, and it seems that we have a good result. There are some parts that we cannot reproduce from our theoretical result because we have some regularity on the pre-al velocity field. This is, for instance, in the numerical result, you have some slope. Yeah, this is a slope in the numerical result. It's not possible to predict that from the theoretical point of view. In some parts also, we have some discrepancy with the analytical criteria. I think the fact that we choose to verify the plastic compressibility in an average sense is a very important approximation, and sometimes it's not so good. So I will stop there. The conclusion is that we've first propose a new methodology. It's from my point of view, maybe it's a new methodology to design macroscopic criteria of porous material by moving to optimization problem. This is due particularly to the plastic compressibility of the solid matrix. And what we are doing now is to implement this macroscopic criterion in a constitutive law and to implement this in a software to make a structural computation. An interesting point also that we have recently addressed for the Drucker-Prague material is the non-associated character of the solid matrix. This is the case also for geomaterial. And the situation is that the limit analysis is not valid in this case. Limit analysis is designed for associated plastic matrix, and we have to move to another theory, and this has been recently published in Journal of Mechanical Physics Solid with Professor Géry de Saxet, when we propose a new variational framework for non-associated matrix by using the so-called bipotential theory. Thank you.
Thank you. We are going to discuss with Luigi Medeo.
Thank you to have given to us the clear limitation of limit analysis with respect to associativeness. You will escape my comment about this point.
Okay, but the paper is now online.
Yeah. For me, it's not clear what is the most important aspect between pressure sensitivity and load angle sensitivity. I think that will be very interesting to compare Drucker-Prager with von Mises, and more the difference is pressure sensitivity, and Drucker-Prager with more Coulomb, because the difference is
load angle
sensitivity.
You are completely right. This is the culinary paper that I'm preparing now, because there is something which is new, but I need to show to people that I have some differences. I have not this here.
Okay.
But it's very important difference. We have shown the difference between Mises and Drucker Prager matrix, there is so many differences, the asymmetry between hydrostatic tensile loading and hydrostatic compression. And now if I move from Drucker to Coulomb, I have some asymmetry between shear stress, asymmetry between the two shear stress. I have not this in the Drucker-Prager case. So in the load angle effect, I have two load angle effects at the local level and at the macroscopic level. And the Coulomb matrix is the very complicated one. And you can see this in the P-plane. In the P-plane, not, it's not homogenization. This is just a Drucker, it's a circle. And the Coulomb is very complicated. So people think sometimes that for the same material, I can use Drucker-Prager or Coulomb. It's not true.
Yes.
You know that it's not true, because the effect of load angle can be sometimes very important. And there is some experiments in geomechanics which clearly show that this effect is important. So the fact that we don't use Coulomb is because it's very difficult to implement Coulomb in numerical point of view. Your paper, your talk will be a Coulomb a word of beautification. I say a Coulomb a word of difficulties, because it's very, very complicated to use. It's clear, it's this dependence on the load angle effect. There is some criterion also proposed by David Bigoni, which is a very nice criterion. Stella will talk a little about that, which contain all the case that we know at now. And it's interesting, we are working also with Stella, if it's possible to make the same thing on the more general criterion of David.
Okay, perfect. When you go from the porosphere to the porosphere, you have to account for a certain number of voids per unit volume.
This is a very important question.
Not clear how you superimpose the different solutions.
Okay, very good and important. In fact, we have two techniques to deal with porous media. The first one is a kinematical approach. It's what I present. I decided to not talk about the other approach, which is a nonlinear homogenization approach. It's a variational approach due to Professor Ponte Castaneda. And the main difference between these two words is that in the case of kinematical analysis, I have to choose a very simple unit cell, because I have to choose a velocity field. So the unit cell is simplified. Classically, we take a holosphere. This means that this corresponds to a real macrostructure. It's what is called assemblage of a sphere of Hachin. This means that you can pave your space with this kind of motif of morphology, and put this one, you have a small one, greater one. This is well known as assemblage de sphère composite d'Hachin. So this corresponds only to this macrostructure, and an interesting question is the result that I obtain, is it valid for all isotropic macroscopic porous media? Any person has to answer to this question now. But in the second approach of nonlinear variational approach, I deal with a representative elementary volume. This is something which is a disordered material, and I can use classical homogenization related to HLB theory. So an interesting question is, can we link between these two approaches of kinematical unit analysis and nonlinear homogenization? We have made, with my ex-PhD student Vincent Moncheri, we have made an attempt to that, but we have just published a paper in Mechanics of Material. I'm not so sure that we have really succeeded, but it's a very interesting question.
I couldn't read your slides very well. Did you show tensile and compressive meridians?
Yes.
And can you show them again?
I have not. This is the result in the meridian plane.
Yeah.
This is the question. I have not this here, but we can see some effect on the result. Okay, the cut in meridian plane is a plane that show the dependence with the hydrostatic pressure. Okay, and what this is the hydrostatic pressure and the equivalent shear. So we have a great effect also of this quantity. It's this one, but I have not plotted this effect. It's exactly what we have to obtain if we go in detail on this equation, this one. Maybe it will be a good idea to put this representation in a stack.
You said you want to apply these also to geotechnical materials. However, in that case, in my opinion, one of the most important, the main difference is that is the degree of saturation.
So, very good question.
This is a comment about what you said. In that case, probably the role of
pore pressure. Yes.
As dual value to pore pressure, the state variable could be just part of this.
Okay, you are completely right. The good thing, good news, is that I have not to do anything after this work, because it has been shown several times before by Patrick Debian and Dormier that in the particular case of Coulomb matrix, I can have an effective stress concept. This means that a combination between the macroscopic stress and the pore pressure, and I have just to replace sigma here by this effective pore pressure. It's not the case for all solid matrices. The effective stress concept has been shown for Mises material, it's Terzaghi one, for Drucker-Prager and Coulomb one. And here we just to replace this stress by effective stress. But a point that you point out also is porosity evolution law. I think that in this case we have just to move to the macroscopy theory of Olivier Cousy. This does work very well because I have now the criteria. And it's for that reason that people working on metallic material, they don't know the Cousy of the theory of Cousy. And they say that this is a state variable. It's what I say. It is not a state variable. If we read well the work of Olivier, it is clear that this cannot be a state variable.
Okay, I propose to skip to the next presentation, which is with Stella. Huh? Je vais de lui complete. Stella is a PhD student.